Hi everyone. So I've remained reasonably quiet on this subject for a fair while, mostly because we hadn't really reached a point where we were talking about close to final-ish hardware. There was still quite a lot in the display side of things to be locked down. We didn't really know what either Sony with their Morpheus or Facebook with their Oculus Rift, how weird does that sound when you say it, was really going to mean from a technical standpoint for developers. Now, with much more information out in the wild from both Sony and Oculus, there's some things I really want to talk about. Now, some of this is going to be slightly uncomfortable for some of you. And when I say some of you, I mean pretty much everybody who doesn't have a high-end PC, and I am including the Sony guys in that statement as well. Okay, let's first discuss what VR is, virtual reality. Now, virtual reality is the idea that you put on a headset and you have a screen that is so close to your eyes that effectively it encapsulates all of your vision. Now, in doing so, that gives you a sense of immersion. When we add head tracking technology, gyroscopes, accelerometers, and so on, we're able to then do tilts to our head. When we move our head, the world moves around us, and this gives us this incredible feeling of immersion. Now, virtual reality is nothing new. It's been kicking around in labs for a very long time, since the 70s from what I can tell. But my first interaction with VR happened in the mid-90s. Visiting some of the larger shopping centres with my parents, I would always spend quite a bit of time in the arcades. One particular year, they had a virtual reality machine that a particular company had put together and brought down and was, I think, charging about £1.50 for 5 minutes of VR. Quite expensive for the time when we were used to putting in, you know, 20p for a good sort of 3 or 4 minutes worth of gameplay on something like Street Fighter. But interestingly, that experience did leave a mark with me. It also left me with incredible nausea for about 2 hours and a feeling like my legs were going to fall from under me. But it did leave a massive impression that at some point in the future, this immersive VR would actually work properly. And it's taken about another 20 odd years for us to actually get to that point. But let's talk about something that's quite important when we deal with modern VR. And it was something that actually first came to prominence with 3D, modern 3D, you know, Avatar. What directors and movie studios discovered was that if you wanted to do 3D properly, you actually needed to double the frame rate. Effectively, you have to deliver 24 frames a second to both eyes simultaneously. But actually, the higher the frame rate you crank it, the better it is for the audience. That's why The Hobbit was originally released in high frame, double frame rate, so that Peter Jackson could deliver a suitable number of frames to both eyes simultaneously, thus giving a feeling of smooth motion. But what does this have to do with virtual reality? Well, the same principle applies here. Because we're dealing with left and right eyes and we're having to try and push a lot of information down the retina and into the brain, we need smooth motion. We can't have frame rate dips. And at no point can we allow the frame rate to drop anything under around 45 frames a second. That essentially means we need 90 frames a second to maintain smooth motion without causing nausea and other kind of problems. Effectively, we need 45 frames a second to each eye as a minimum. That's our sweet spot, and that's something that Oculus have been talking about. Now, as you can imagine, if we need to deliver 90 frames a second of information from our games console or our PC to the VR headset, that is quite a high bar to hit when the vast majority of computers out there can't do even 60 frames a second stably. Now, what we need to kind of understand here is VR is a different beast for development point of view. The worlds are not going to be as big and vast as we would expect in, say, something like The Witcher 3. What we'll find is to be able to actually deliver that high frame rate that we need, compromises will have to be made. Smaller worlds, potentially. Texture size, not a big problem, because at the end of the day, that's more of a video memory issue. But really, it's all about here. It's about what we can draw on the screen and how quickly we can draw it without dropping that frame rate. More importantly, that frame rate must never drop under that 90 threshold. But that brings me on to why Sony people may not be all that happy with this video. Because there's a big problem here for the consoles, which I think might be why Microsoft has taken a different approach. I'll talk about that in a moment. So, the PlayStation 4 and Morpheus. Sony have taken the decision to go with a 120 frames per second display. Effectively, they're going to drive 120 frames a second into your eyes. You know, not physically, but you know, you get what I mean. The point here is that to do that on a PlayStation 4, they are having to do a software cheat, in some respects, to double the frame rate coming out of the frame buffer on the PS4 to 120 frames a second. Now, why is this a potential problem for the PlayStation 4 and for VR when it's seen within the PlayStation ecosystem? Well, here's the issue. How many games do we have on PS4 that are capable of doing 60 frames a second stable, with never a dropped frame, and crucially, are able to produce large worlds three-dimensionally? There's actually not that many. And when we look at the ones that there are, we see that there are limitations there. Call of Duty springs to mind. If you think about the way the world works within Call of Duty's engine, it's very small. The worlds are not big and expansive. They don't have long draw distances or high level of detail. And for me, I think this is the key indicator as to certainly how the first generation of VR is going to work, bearing in mind that VR headsets themselves, the technology we've got there will progress very quickly, but they are absolutely reliant on the processing power of their host system. Now this potentially, for me, combined with the extra data that the systems have to handle coming from VR, not only the positional tracking data, but also the actual interactions from the controls themselves, I get this very serious sense that we are not going to see the PlayStation 4 deliver convincing VR in comparison to something like the Oculus Rift or even what HTC and Steam are doing, Valve are doing. But for my mind, this is kind of the bottleneck that Sony have got here. They've not proven their console can do 60 frames a second absolutely rock solid stably, and yet they're still having to then push to the 120 frames a second. Why didn't they go for 45 frames a second and double it to 90, which is what effectively Oculus is aiming for, only without the doubler? It strikes me as a little odd that essentially Sony might be about to gimp developers and the performance envelope of the PlayStation 4 with VR purely to hit a really big number. It seems a little odd to me, and I cannot escape the fact that the PlayStation 4 is not going to deliver the expansive worlds that I think VR people are going to be interested in. It's going to be an interesting one. And again, what does this mean for VR on consoles from a point of view of every game? Is it going to be a case that we can take, say, Battlefield and put it on our PlayStation 4, stick our VR headset on, and just enjoy the game? I don't think that's going to be possible, because it's all about achieving that solid 60 frames a second so it can be doubled to 120. If you've got the frame rate drifting up and down, or you've got effectively slow frame times or anything like that, that's going to mess up that software interpolation that's boosting the frame rate to 120. I just can't see how this is going to work for Sony without limiting something somewhere. There's going to have to be a drawdown on power, and I can't see personally that it's going to be every single game on PlayStation 4 that can make use of VR. It's going to have to be custom built applications and services effectively to make use of this power envelope, which is constrained because of what Sony are trying to do here. Now things are obviously different for Microsoft. If you actually look at what HoloLens is doing, they're taking a much lower resolution display for starters. Not widescreen, lower frame rate by the looks of it as well, and because they're painting on top of a video layer, as it were, of the environment around them, essentially it's kind of like a cut down version of VR. Obviously theirs is more an AR based system, artificial reality rather than virtual reality, but I still think it's interesting the way Microsoft has kind of pegged this. They haven't gone down the VR route because quite frankly the Xbox One can't handle it. And again, I think the performance envelope that the Xbox One has, PlayStation 4, they're not too dissimilar in their architectures. A little bit more GPU power in the PS4, which is going to help it, but as we've seen in benchmarks, the difference isn't great enough to make me think that hitting 60 frames a second stable, doubling it to 120 on the PS4 is going to work particularly well. It's a strange thing, isn't it, really? Now, for my mind, if we're talking about VR in the future, we are really going to be talking about where Sony, Microsoft go next. It's not this current generation hardware. For my mind, Sony jumped on the bandwagon of VR. It wasn't something that was really intended for the PlayStation 4, not until they started seeing what Oculus was doing. Then they realized quite quickly and easily that this was something that was very cheap to produce. What you have to bear in mind is all of the cost of VR goes into its R&D, not actually into the physical hardware that we end up getting, because we're dealing with smartphone displays at the end of the day. If you look at what's running in the Oculus Rift, they are Samsung Note displays. It's as simple as that. So there's been a great way here for the mobile manufacturers to also jump into this new market, which is why there's been this bit of a stampede around it, and lots of sharing of technology. They see this as a great way to attach a new product, not only onto consoles, but to smartphones, to PCs, and then to kick off a new wave of content generation. At the end of the day, content then tends to sell devices and so on. It's one of those interesting problems for the industry where you kind of have this opportunity to create a whole new marketplace, but actually, I don't think the technology we have is suitable yet for what we're trying to do. I think we're actually talking at least 3 more years before VR is able to do 120 frames a second, stable, natively, no doubling. And it's at that point that the idea of immersive VR is really going to happen. That's also probably the point where the slightly scary singularity starts to happen and we all just jump into a virtual world and abandon our real world bodies. But hey, at the end of the day, VR is an incredible opportunity for everybody, not just for technology companies, but for us as consumers of content, for people who are working in medical fields or engineering fields. It changes the, well, entire way we view and interact with the world and our technology. But I don't think it's ready yet. When you look at Oculus Rift's very high benchmark requirements to get that 90 frames a second, you're talking a 970 GPU and obviously quad-core processors there for the win. It just feels to me that actually we're talking 3 years out when the power of a 970 is actually available in around £100 to £150 graphics card. At that point, the market will explode. But of course, we have to ask ourselves if for Oculus and for general consumers, we're talking 3 years. What the heck is the point in trying to put it onto a Sony PlayStation 4, which is hopelessly underpowered to maintain those 60 frames a second stable without compromising what developers are going to actually be able to do? Let me know in the comments what you think. I know this has been a longer video, it's been a bit of a discussion as it were, so let me know what you think of VR. Do you think it's going to be the next big thing? Do you think it's going to happen in 2016? Or do you really think we're talking maybe 3 to 5 years before this becomes viable technology that you could just plug in and play with a great range of content that runs at that stable frame rate lock we need?